Yes. So objectives of my talk today are introduction to talk about three-tier approach to select the patients who are eligible for cooling, the use of amplitude integrated EEG in case of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, some of the controversies in cooling, and some of the adjuvant treatment to augment cooling, aggravating factors, and multi-organ system failure. So neonatal encephalopathy, it is simply describing a broad definition of abnormal mental status. There is brain dysfunction. It is manifested by abnormal neurological examination. It's either abnormality or difficulty to initiate breathing or to sustain breathing. Plus, there will be abnormal tone or abnormal reflexes. Mental status, or what we call it, level of consciousness, will not be the normal or at the level expected, plus or minus presence of the seizures. All of these not attributed to a specific reason. That's why we call it the broad definition of neonatal encephalopathy. If I have a specific diagnosis for that, once you have an event that can highlight it, a hypoxic ischemic event that has led to the encephalopathy, I would call it HIE. It counts to be like 16% of admissions, relative causes for neonatal admissions, and the third most common after the neonatal sepsis and prematurity. Neonatal encephalopathy due to the event of hypoxia ischemia occurs in 2 out of every 1,000 live births, while in developing countries, unfortunately, this number is higher. HIE outcomes regarding mortality and morbidity, up till 20% of them will die within the postnatal age, and up till 25% of them who suffer the severe HIE will end up having severe childhood disabilities under the broad name of cerebral palsy, cognitive impairment, and so on. Only 50% of the HIE cases can be anticipated and hence can be promptly acted on, hopefully trying to prevent it from happening. Looking for the underlying pathophysiology for the hypoxic ischemic, once the insult will happen, there will be various cascade of processes that will ensue and start to go on. It is at cellular and at metabolic level. The cascade of each of these will lead at the end to what we call it the diasis of the cell membrane, to the cell death, the apoptosis, necrotic. It comes as phases. It is attributed also to the presence of failure of the energy production because the mitochondria is no more functioning as it is expected to be. There will be gush of the sodium, cell swell, and diasis of the membrane cell death. There will be calcium and excitotoxicity material like the glutamate that will be also ensured into the cells, and it will cause all the success one after the other, and this will cause the propagation of the insult to ensue and continue. So it is, we are here talking about two levels, the primary energy failure, which happens within few minutes, few first hours, that if not stopped, will continue after the reperfusion to go to the secondary energy failure, which takes hours to days, and this is covered by the up to 72 hours, which is the period of cooling. And here we highlight the importance of having the therapeutic window where we always must start the therapeutic hypothermia within the first 6 hours of presentation. So knowing the underlying pathophysiology, we can think of a modality that ameliorates the outcome. If we talked about the effects of the insult that has happened. So we are here going to go for the reverse of what has happened. Suppression of the cell death, suppression of the inflammation, and preservation of the blood-brain barrier. As we saw, it is acute, it is subacute and chronic phase. So from bench to the bedside, cooling studies have started since 1950 in the animal kingdom, in 2005, when the encephalopathy. And since 2010, NICH has considered to be the main mode of treatment. These are the six and divide randomized trials. And as you see, the Lozengen and all of them are going with the in favor to go for the hypothermia treatment, with the number needed to treat is 7. Next topic will be the three-tier approach to select patients who are eligible for cooling. So the tier approach is step after the other, and one step will give you the reason to go for the next step. First thing to start with is if there is a perinatal event that has caused asphyxia, this is my first question to be answered. So if there is a correlated asphyxia, how can I get this answer from what I have in my scene at the time of injury? If there is a correlated history of any event that has happened pre, at time of delivery, or postnatal, just around the time of delivery, it might be related to the maternal, fetal-maternal, or fetal, for the newborn baby. If this it could be like uterine rupture, a rupture placenta, profound maternal hypotension, and this event. Is it enough by itself? No. So we'll go, the next one is the Apgar score. At 5, at 10 minutes, if the Apgar score is less than 5, this can be related to a presence of asphyxia. But is it a specific? No. It is a very big and wide range of reasons that can give me a low Apgar score, like CNS malformation, infection, inflammation, CNS, maybe hemorrhage, maybe underlying metabolic disease, hyperbilirubinemia, maybe use of toxins. So Apgar score by itself is not sufficient to label that I have a correlated asphyxia event. If I will combine it with the presence of profound acidemia, in which the first pH, preferably to be the core pH less than 7, and a base deficit of more than 16, then both together can tell me, yes, there was an asphyxia that has happened related to the event that has issued here. And here I have labeled and answered my first question. There, perinatal asphyxia. Yeah. I come then to the next. Does this perinatal asphyxia lead to encephalopathy picture that we have just talked about? How can I get that? By the neurological examination. I will assess the baby and I get my results from assessing the newborn baby, and accordingly we'll see. If there is no encephalopathy, this is my category for talking today. Neonatal encephalopathy, if they are within the moderate and the severe ones, then these are the ones eligible and they will get benefit from cooling, while the mild ones will be again left out. But is it always clear? No, sometimes we end up having a gray zone in between. For these gray cases in which you are not clear about the asphyxia pattern, you are not clear about perinatal history. Maybe you got a patient delivered somewhere outside and we transferred to your hospital. So I'm not aware. Maybe you don't have blood gas in hand. Maybe a gas was not attended. Maybe the mother had delivered at home and you got the baby. So these gray cases, which are not clear about it, we have here the tier 3, which is the use of the functional cerebral monitoring, which is the amplitude integrated EEG. Here, if we have the amplitude integrated EEG with a positive result, then I will include this baby to be within those who are eligible for cooling and might get the benefit of that. So the rule here is, if I want to cool, I have to have perinatal asphyxia and encephalopathy related to this event. And what did I say? Neurological, sorry. Amplitude integrated EEG to short out the guys in the case. It is different than some of the events. Making the body and the third one at the right time just to call it nice suggestion. If the normal trace is there, and simply if we talk about the normal trace, we look at the condensed color at the middle, we look at the upper limit of the amplitude and the lower limit of the amplitude. My two numbers are 5 and 10. If both above 5 and 10 and the condensed area is quite that way, then not. The moderate abnormality, the upper limit stays above 10, but the lower limit will go down below 5, giving it a bit wider presentation of the dense area in the middle. While the severe suppression will be either the burst suppression, low or flat, in which there will be very less electrical activity detected, or abnormal and not related. In a more clear way, this is the normal. This is the wide one, moderately abnormal, with the lower amplitude goes below 5. And these are the different patterns of the severe abnormal. Next one is to use the amplitude integrated EEG in HIE, not only to sort out the gray cases, but if I will use it to detect what will be the future to predict the severity of the disability for this baby, counsel the parents to put them in the view, because we are at the end decision making together. Or at any time, the use of the amplitude integrated EEG will help us to get or detect the subclinical seizures. Is the amplitude integrated EEG alone enough? No, because it can still lift up to 2/3 of the seizures, which are these ones, the ones which are brief, are unfrequent, or with a low amplitude. But if I will combine it with the conventional EEG that we used to use, it can give us the yield up to 85% of seizures can be detected. Cooling has found in regard to use at the time of moderate HIV, it will decrease the seizure time from 200 minutes down to 60 minutes, but has nothing to do with the frequency of seizures. While in cases of severe HIV, cooling will never affect neither the frequency nor the duration of the seizure. These are different presentations of seizure patterns. And here alternating with the severe abnormal EEG. And here maybe there is some intervention was given that has suppressed the arrhythmic repetitive pattern of size. The positive predictive value of amplitude integrated EEG for disabilities, as we have said, as you have mentioned, in the first 6 hours of time, it can give me a yield up to 75% in cases which were untreated. If I have a baby who's going in the gray zone, I put the AEG, it is giving me, yes, this baby will be subjected to go to the cooling arm. Then the positive predictive value for that will be around 75%. In cases which I will later go for predictive of disability for the future, the yield will be up to 98% in cases which, if I would say within day three, and if let's say the baby from the beginning was not the dose who are treated for cooling, but it is advised to go for this once a day three for amplitude integrated AEG. If this case there was from the beginning any abnormality, then the yield is 98%. If there was nothing, then I can give guarantee for the parents with a high negative predictive value. Some of the controversies in cooling. According to Ben and his team, since 1997, they have induced the hypoxia ischemia to a number of sheep, and they have subjected them to go for cooling. They found that the group who has been cooled at age 1.5 hours and 5.5 hours were those who has missed neuronal loss at the end. In contrast to the last group, were cooled later at around 8.5 hours, which has came up maybe to 80, even higher than 80% of neuronal loss. So this gives us that cooling very soon is the best, and the more the delay of initiation of cooling, the more the damage. Other some of the controversies or new updates about the therapy hypothermia for late preterm, as we know that we are treating with the cooling for this one at 35 weeks or higher. A study from NICHD going to involve then down up to 33 weeks. Last update on the research date was in December 2022, and no result has been posted on the 5 years. Regarding therapeutic hypothermia for 10 presenting later than 6 hours, if I put a baby with the more than 6 hours, will you cool or not? If they are studying it cooling beyond 6 hours after 24 hours, and the cooling will go further than 72 hours, reaching 96 hours. And the last update was in March 9, 2021. But sometimes what we say in the hospital, because still there are some cases in which you will stand and say, if I am in doubt and I have nothing in hand, I will. Passive cooling versus self-regulated cooling, this is mainly for the in-route cooling. Let's say that the cooling has been established or started for the end of shift in one hospital, but they are planning to transfer the to another hospital, potential hospital, or very well established to deal with the hypoxic ischemic cases. Then on-route, it is found that fluctuation of temperature or not steady, sometimes it will go even below 33 or higher than what is expected or needed for the baby, this fluctuation will cause more harm. So the servo-regulated with a probe either esophageally or rectally inserted is better. Regarding head cooling versus the whole body cooling, statistically significant, there is no difference between them, but for the feasibility and easy use, the whole body cooling, pico-therm or blanket, found to be easy to use. What about regarding deeper or longer? Deeper than 33.5 going down to 30, or longer than 72 hours up to 120 hours or together. In ICSP optimizing cooling trial has stopped running units after a certain number because they found the candidates were those who are subjected for deeper cooling needed more use of INO, and those who were subjected to longer period of cooling when higher risk and anuria and death. So regarding the non-sedative early MRI, MRS, the timing for this is preferred to be between 5 to 15 days. First 10 days are the best. For us in our unit, we could get it done يعني, day 4, maximum by day 7. يعني once we stop the cooling, day 4, we can do it. If for a reason or another, we can go maximum by day 7. The MRI, most accurate modality in evaluating the neonatal encephalopathy in comparison to other radiological diagnostic modalities. It detects the localization, the extension, and the severity. Regarding the MRS, mainly here we are talking about the surge, the waves of the presence of lactate or NAA, N-acetyl aspartate. It talks mainly about viability of the brain tissue, and the worst outcome comes when there is reverse of these two surges, higher lactate peak and very low NAA peak. Lactate is known to be the one of failed oxidative phosphorylation, and the NAA is the marker of neuronal axonal density and viability. And looking in one of the studies, we got a chance to meet with Dr. Raniki 2 weeks back, another conference here, and we really talked and we liked the fact that she has presented. Looking in the outcome in regard to model outcome, cognitive analysis, assessed by Bailey 3 score and the gross motor function score. Regarding the mammillary body atrophy and the other MRI correlates of school age outcome following the HIE. The mammary bodies, the MDs, are projections into the anterior thalamic nuclei. They found to be very sensitive to hypoxia, but subjecting these cases to have the therapeutic hypothermia found not to have the real impact that they were expecting it to have. Here we need an expert or very well-trained physicians and radiologists to read properly these kind of radiological modalities. And further research is needed to assess the role of therapeutic hypothermia in the mammillary body in neonatal encephalopathy. Regarding the adjuvant treatment to augment cooling, here we are talking about cooling as a baseline, and add on that the use of any other substance that might ameliorate or help the therapeutic cooling, the therapeutic hypothermia, such as adenosine, xenon, melatonin, amiprinol, erythropoietin, and stem cells, and some of them are started to get the results and يعني, for discussion and kind of promising. Regarding the multi-organ system failure and aggravating factors, we know that the hypoxic ischemia is not only about the brain, it's the whole body, it's all the systems, each and every system and organ in the body might be affected. Regarding the respiratory system, starting from the central apnea down to meconium aspiration syndrome with the PPHM, pulmonary edema or hemorrhage and so on, cardiovascular arrhythmias, myocardial depression, bradycardia, profound hypotension and need the use of anaerobic support, infection up to 12% of cases, acute kidney injury, it could be the unoligoric or the oligoric or the aspirate, it is the acute tubular necrosis picture, GI like disturbed liver function and picture of neck or inability to feed, the difficulties with feeding, hematology, prolonged coagulation profile and thrombocytopenia. But the good news that by one of the studies found that by age of 5 years, none of the other systems other than the brain will continue to have the impact of the HI event that has happened and caused the encephalopathy. Aggravating factors are too many. We have to keep a proper electrolyte management is very important and crucial, as HIE can cause hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and hypoglycemia. Of course, oxygen and free radicals, we have always to keep the oxygen within the norm, not higher, not of course lower. Hypocapnia will affect the blood-brain barrier and it will cause also the deleterious effect. Sometimes at rewarming, this might be a trigger to have seizures which were not evident when the baby was at the cooling. Here we have to stop, sit back, and cool and the rewarm later, but on a longer period instead of doing it. And you will adjust your machine to go with that. And of course, we talked about deeper or longer period and many other aggravating tailored according to the individual cases. So, in summary, from our talk today, the three-tier approach to select patients who are eligible for cooling. The use of amplitude integrated EEG in cases of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy is not only to filter the gray cases. Therapeutic window time is crucial. When we say it is 6 hours, or the earlier the better. And regarding discussion and counseling the parents, we have always to let them know that therapeutic hypothermia is not a magic bullet. We have to know that sometimes the sequelae in the future might be يعني the end result of that. That was my talk for today. Thank you very much.